Day 24 on the road to the lodge.
It smells really good. You can smell the...
massive interest rate rise.
What is the RBA's cash rate?
The RBA's cash rate is at 0.35.
The interest rate hike and the pain coming for homeowners dominating the day. Both leaders spinning the financial sting.
Australians, when they cast their vote, can think about this. Is this as good as it gets?
I'm not going to tell them a fairy tale like the Labor Party is, that somehow how you vote on that day is going to make international pressures just vanish.
The PM once again raising his economic shield.
What the Reserve Bank Governor has said is that Australia's economic policies have been working through the pandemic, have provided a shield to the Australian economy, which has enabled it to strengthen and come back again.
The Labor leader talking up his plans to ease the burden.
Labor has a plan, whether it be for cheaper childcare, cheaper electricity prices. This is all about growing the economy in a way that doesn't add to inflationary pressure.
The rate rise centre stage as the men who would be the next treasurer squared off at the press club.
Let's get ready to rumble!
Of course, the Labor Party is always holier than now.
Josh is fighting the last election again.
We know the Labor Party will always tax more. They'll always spend more.
The Treasurer's just lied to you. This government has taxed more than the last Labor government. That's just a fact.
And with inflation expected to peak at 6% before the year is out, just how are both sides planning to rein it in?
Are either of you prepared to make discretionary spending cuts or tax rises to help take pressure off the RBA on inflation and lifting interest rates?
The Reserve Bank yesterday, in their words, these are not mine, the main driver of inflation has been international factors.
The budget's got $1 trillion in debt in it with not enough to show for it. Only one side in this election is being upfront with people about the task ahead.
Thank you to both of you for answering or not answering our questions.
Well, that clears that up then.
Yes, the not answering. Economist Shane Wright was at the press club today. He joins us now. Shane, so which wannabe treasurer was the winner for you?
I reckon it was Jim Chalmers by the top of a pencil, probably a H2 pencil for these economic types. It was pretty tight. Neither tried to answer a question fully, but I think it was just Josh Frydenberg asked a question of Jim Chalmers, which seemed to go on forever, and Chalmers was able to dispatch that to the leg side pretty quickly. And I think that was possibly the only difference between the two.
I like that you said neither tried to answer a question. Not that they failed.
That's exactly what I said.
They didn't try. Which is an amazing turn of phrase. They were both asked, one of the questions they didn't try to answer was about wages, which I think is interesting because the Labor framed it as a key election issue really early on. But since then, I've found it anyway really difficult to pin down how exactly each party's position is going to have any effect on wage stagnation. Can you help me out there?
Well, look, I'll need a textbook and and a very large grant from a university to explain where they're going, because it isn't absolutely clear how both sides are going to turn around what's been a problem for the last 8 or 9 years. But in terms of direct policy saying Jim Chalmers or Josh Frydenberg's going to give you a $10 an hour pay rise, yeah, I've got a bridge to sell you, don't worry.
Yeah. Shane, there's a bit of a spendathon going on at the moment. It seems to me that neither of the major parties are making life easy for the Reserve Bank Governor.
Goodness, no. And you look at the budget, so only 5 weeks ago, so there's the $5 billion that was promised in those the $250 handout, the cheap petrol. Then we get to the middle of the year, there's another $12 billion in the supersized lower middle income tax offset, plus everything that's been promised by both sides over the last 3.5 weeks. That is working against what the Reserve Bank is worried about. That is adding to inflation. And some of the spending initiatives don't pass a sniff test either in terms of what they're going to do. If you're going to spend money to improve the economy, get productivity going, well, knock yourself out. But not when you're throwing money around like it's Monopoly cash.
Shane, I missed the debate, this enthralling debate where neither party leader tried to answer a question. But dog parks, explain.
Bloody dog parks. Look, my hound and I, Scully the super dog, you'll catch her on Instagram.
Got a photo. There we go.
And that was a selfie, I believe, which is amazing.
And she's a smart dog, let me assure you. So we go out for a run without taxpayers funding our run. But the federal, the coalition has promised $320,000 to build a new dog park in the marginal Liberal seat of Latrobe in the southeast suburbs of Melbourne. Labor has promised $200,000 to upgrade two dog parks in the marginal Labor-held seat of Macquarie in the Blue Mountains of Sydney. Now, forgive me for suggesting that federal taxpayers' money should not be used to look after some pampered pooches. And as I love my pooch, we all know that. But that's the situation we've got to. This is ultra-targeted spending. And let's not forget, the budget deficit's about $80 billion this year, about $80 billion next year. Debt is about $885 billion. The interest bill on that is going up. But we've got space to spend money on a fence, some cheap water and some grass for dogs, just who happen to be in marginal seats. Mm. And this is the stupidity of electioneering at this point in time.
Such a waste of money. Dogs don't even vote. I mean, it's ridiculous. It's ridiculous.
I know. And like, Scully has troubles just getting the pencil in between her fingers. Like, yeah. It's a problem. It's
yeah. Scully has fingers?
Yeah. Wow. I told Scully, you she's a smart selfies. Dog. She's a smart dog. Yeah.
Shane Scully and the case of the mysterious costly dog park. Yes. Mm. Here's a podcast in it, Shane Swansang. There's a podcast in it. Thank you so much for your time.
No troubles, guys.
True crime, you're thinking? Is that what
definitely.
You're
definitely. Yep. Yeah. Yep. It'd be a hit.
Excellent.
Yeah, everyone would want it.
This is fun, isn't it, Barry? The fact that... not the dog stuff, but... Well, the interest rate rise has just completely changed the political conversation, hasn't it?
Yeah, but it probably shouldn't, in a sense, because I think of all the economic barometers out there, the one that governments have least control over are interest rates. And so given that, I don't think there's a whole lot in this for the Labor Party for a couple of reasons, because they're coming off emergency levels. The free money was set because of the pandemic. But having said that, and because of that, and in the interest of consistency, maybe they could stop saying that interest rates will always be lower under a coalition government, right?
Yeah, that's right.
What did you take about Shane's phrase there when he said the stupidity of electioneering at this time? You've covered so many campaigns, and I know so many voters, and we at times also get just like
he's so only into the fourth week of the campaign.
Yeah, you're right.
That's cynicism already.
Young bucks, Barry.
Yeah.
I know, but it just seems, I don't know, where's the hope coming for?
He got stuck into the pampered pooches, you know, and then why should you be pampering the dogs? But, you know, we pamper billionaires who own whiskey distilleries in Tasmania. I mean, somebody got $4 billion and they're making a profit. Mm. So it's not just the dogs that are, you know, picking up this money for political purposes.
So you'd rather the dogs than the billionaires? Okay.
Neither. What... Look, it's just too much of this rubbish goes on.
So this, but this is the meaningful point about all this, right? And Shane's kind of making this point. They're throwing money at an economy that's overheating. That's why we've got inflation.
Right? Yep.
Is there any way, could you see any party not spend that money and win an election?
Well, you mean, can they be honest and win an election? I mean, Bob Hawke won an election with interest rates of 17%. I mean, he didn't get into a panic, but I'll bet they spent a lot of money back then.
Also the 80s, right?
Yeah.
It's a very different era.
Yeah, so it's... no, probably not. It's always thus. And it's not just that. Like, people apparently have saved a lot of money through the pandemic. Now they're about to spend that as well. So the economy's going to overheat one way or another.
So is that what the coalition means, though, when they say that interest rates will be higher under Labor? Do they mean that Labor's going to spend more and inflate?
Well, they will be this time because we know they're going up, right?
They're going up.
They'll get it right if you just look at very recent history, but it's not something you can manage.
So it's a weird situation, right, because you mentioned the emergency levels and you mentioned the fact, like, the pandemic is central to a lot of this.
Yep.
And we're kind of brushing it, Labor especially is brushing it out of a lot of conversation. Mm. But part of the reason the economy's overheating is there's so much money has been pumped in, right? The government has just spent heroic amounts of money. So... how would you calibrate it? Because, you know, if you turn a money hose at the economy, things can get out of control.
Yeah.
How can you stimulate but then not overheat?
Well, it's hard to do, but, I mean, right now it's absolutely essential because it's a structural budget deficit.
Yeah.
There's a deficit built into the economy for the next 10 years. Yeah. So whoever wins this election have just got to change the rhetoric and change the attitudes.
Yeah, so not emergency spending. That's the problem, the structural stuff. It's going to come back year after year.
Yeah, that's over.